And opinions of the hosts and guests are their own and do not necessarily reflect the position of the management and staff of Guardian Network. Not afraid to take a stand.
Off the Record with Zhivargo Laing is sponsored by Royal Fidelity Bank and Trust, Royal Star Assurance, Fidelity Bank Bahamas, BTC, the Cleveland Clinic, the Digital Transformation Unit, and the Insurance Commission of the Bahamas.
Gentlemen, to Z Live, I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. So glad you could join us here today on Guardian Radio 96.9 FM on this beautiful Wednesday afternoon. We got started real late. Sorry about that. We've got a good discussion to have today. If you want to call, the numbers are 323-6232. That's 323-6232. Or 325-4316, 325-4316, or 325-4259. That's 325-4259. You can text us on 422-4796. That's 422-4796. Or you can WhatsApp me on 439-3043. That's 439-3043. My mother is listening, I believe, on Cable Bahamas, channel 969. Or you can catch us on BTC Flow, channel 612. BTC Flow, channel 612. Listen, there are people that you meet in your lifetime that, and this isn't true of a lot of people I've ever met, but this is true of some people I've ever met. And when you first meet them, they make a wonderful impression on you. As you continue to interact with them, they continue to make a wonderful impression on you. The last time you could ever remember connecting with them, they made a wonderful impression on you. You observe their life's dealings and you see the kind of easiness with which they navigate the world, easiness with which they interact with people, and the kind of positive impact that they have on people. They seem in harmony with life in many ways, right? And sometimes these people have some of the most noble professions you could ever dream of, which is to be a teacher. Listen to me, man. You could be a doctor, a lawyer, an Indian, a chief. Like, if you are a teacher, you are a foundational profession and career for every other profession and career. Because, like, you are the problem solver for the problem of ignorance in the world, right? You are the one who is trying to get people to understand what the world is like, how to navigate it, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. You're not the be all and end all of it all, but you're a teacher. You're special on the planet. That's not even a debate for me, hands down. So anyway, sometimes these people are teachers. Well, I have to tell you, Anita Doherty, who was the principal at BMES, Bishop Michael Eldon School in Grand Bahama, who was a veteran educator, a legendary sports presence in Grand Bahama and throughout the country. And just one such human being like the one I talked about. Like Anita Doherty to me was just like the same person every single time I ever met her. You know what I mean? She just exuded the pleasantness, at least for me. And whenever you see her had to get serious with you, even though she had to get serious with you, there still was a kind of softness about it that enabled you to take like the discipline she had to give to you, right? Well, Anita Doherty passed away only now 2 days. And I have to pay tribute to this very special lady. If you meet her son, that I often interact with, same kind of just calm, decent, friendly human being, right? And so my condolences to their family on the passing of this great educator, this great sports figure, this great personality, Anita Doherty. I mean, I'm telling you, folks in Grand Bahama and throughout the Bahamas who heard this news, they are devastated. They know this person, they know what she has meant to so many students, so many teachers, so many friends, so many athletes. And, you know, well done. Well done, Anita. Well done, and God bless you and your family in this difficult time, I know, for them. God bless them. Yeah. All right. So, one, McCartney and I had no discussions about what I was going to talk about, what he was going to talk about. It's not unusual that sometimes things penetrate public sphere that result in us, all of us, speaking about the same kinds of things. And so this issue of police in school did catch my attention. It did catch my attention. Now, again, you know that when I come at these things, I come at them from the point of view of trying to see some framework, policy perspective in our approach to this. So I have put to myself and to you the question, like, when is it the right time to do a thing like this? We know that under ordinary circumstances, we don't have police officers in schools. That's really a recent development, like in the last 12 to 15 years, but it's not been a normal thing to put police in schools. And administrations have fluctuated between this. The Christie administration really started this notion of police in schools. When the Ingram administration came in, it was not something that was supported, and so police were withdrawn from school. The Christie administration, on their return, returned them to school. And so there's been obviously a policy difference between the Free National Movement and the Progressive Liberal Party on this. The Menace administration did not have police in school, even though for much of that administration, they had to contend with the pandemic and wasn't much schooling to be schooled. But even before that, there wasn't police in school. And now we have the Davis administration, which did not, as a matter of promise or proactive consideration, put police in school, but as a reaction to an incident or couple of incidents of violence in schools. And the question then becomes one of, is putting police in school justifiable? Really, more profoundly, is there any evidence to support that doing so makes a difference? And if there is evidence to support it makes a difference, what difference does it make? See, what we have to understand something. The government has the right, the authority to do what it's doing in terms of putting police in school, don't put police in school. The government certainly has the authority to do that, and we see the government exercising that authority. But the exercise of power, the exercise of authority, should be grounded in reasoning. All right? That's a fact. It shouldn't be grounded in reaction. It should be grounded in reasoning. So a child gets stopped. Another child gets stopped. Maybe three or four children get stopped in several schools. The reaction is do something. That's a good instinct to do something, right? That's a good instinct. But you can do something that doesn't make sense. You can do something that makes sense. You can do something that makes an impact. You can do something that doesn't make an impact. If it is merely a question of doing something so as to appear to be doing something without reason, then that's not good policy sense. So what is good policy sense? Good policy sense is we have looked into this situation. We have spoken to the people we regard as knowledgeable. In this case, might be educators, security personnel, and that kind of stuff. We have looked at what maybe if there exists research and what that research might tell us about what is doable and possible in these circumstances. Some of that might be internationally, some might be local, et cetera. But we've done that, and on the basis of all of that, we have decided X, Y, and Z. So that's where good policy decision-making comes in. And so the decision has been made to put police in school, a few police spread across the schools. And I'm not alarmed by a few police have spread across the school, because if you look at the police population relative to the population of the country, we have a citizenry of 389,000, and we have a police population maybe of about 3,000. So if you look at that as a percentage, you're talking essentially about the police being 0.7%, less than 1% of the population. Less than 1% of the population. If you look at the school population, if you put 9 police officers in the school population in New Providence, which might be about 40,000 or thereabouts, you're talking about a 0.02% of the population. So clearly, the police presence in the school does not reflect the police presence in the society generally in terms of percentage. Okay. Now you could narrow that down and say, okay, let's look at just the high school population of the country, and that would get you closer to maybe 0.05% or something like that, and so forth and so forth. But I don't worry about it, because if you look at the broader population, the police ain't gonna be everywhere at the same time. Maybe not gonna be most places at the same time. So that's why crime happens, right? And so that's, for me, that's not the issue. For me is, well, this is the first issue for me. Like, is there really an out of control problem in the schools in the Commonwealth of the Bahamas? And what's the evidence of that? Listen, I don't want anybody to be offended. I don't want anybody to think I'm being critical of them. This is a talk show. We explore ideas. We explore the issues that exist in our society. And I'm asking you, I live in the Bahamas. I live right here. I have a child in school in the Bahamas. I have nephews and nieces in schools in the Bahamas. I have friends with children in the schools in the Bahamas. And I'm asking you, public or private school, do we have an out of control problem of violence among students in our schools? I didn't say we have violence in our schools at all. I mean, where you could go and don't have some incidences of violence where human beings are interacting with each other. But I'm asking you, do you have an out of control problem in the society? Do we have, even if it ain't out of control, do we have a really significant violence problem in our schools? I mean, that would require police presence in the schools. I'm not asking you if you feel better about police being in the school, because I'm going to talk about some research that talks about that in a while. But so this isn't a question of whether you feel better. Because some of us, we get it mixed up. You can feel any kind of way, right? Let me tell you what is true. They do two kinds of assessments when they look at crimes in societies. They do an assessment of the actual incidences of crime. So what has been reported by the police? What has the police been able to find on? So that's the actual incidence of crime. And then they do a survey among citizenry about whether they feel that crime is so-and-so or not. And oftentimes what citizens feel about crime doesn't match the actual incidences of crime, right? So for instance, there are people who are much higher at risk for getting mugged in a downtown area where there's lots of people moving about than there are people who are at risk for getting mugged while they're walking past a forest in the night, because the forest isn't populated. Yet, most people feel less safe walking past a forest in the night than they feel in the day walking about downtown with lots of people around. That's how they feel, even though the probability of being victimized by crime is less walking past the forest than in downtown area. Most people feel more at risk flying in an airplane than they feel at risk driving in a car, even though the probability of crashing in an airplane is substantially less than crashing in a car, dying in an airplane than dying in a car accident. So this isn't about how you feel or how I feel about other police. I'm asking, like, is there hard evidence to support that violence in our schools, and there are 20-something in New Providence, I think, public schools, is out of control or really substantial to warrant that we take police resources and place them in our schools, however little they in number they are? That's the first question. Because if to discuss police in school, that we have to first ask, like, why do it? Would you do something when something isn't warranted, right? Like, would you begin to put police officers to man toilet facilities out at Queen Elizabeth Sports Center? Like, would you do that now? Why? People would say, like, well, that's crazy. Why would you do that? Because it isn't necessary. Well, the question becomes one of, is it necessary? Now, this could be a matter of opinion, but in the incidents, in the circumstances of our schools, it doesn't have to be, because we can look at the incidences. As somebody said to us, within the last year, we have had X number of incidences, and we have a threshold that we look at that says that if we pass X number of incidences, we think that should trigger some special action. I know somebody could say, oh, but Mr. Laing, any child getting stabbed in the school, we should take action, et cetera, et cetera. Yeah, that sounds emotionally good. It really does. And I know it sounds so wonderful, beautiful. But there are other consequences to having police officers in school. We'll get to in a while. So it's not just, you can't just look at one side of the picture, right? It's Texas, Mr. Laing, you posed a question. Do we have an out of control problem regarding violence in our schools? But I want to ask you to define out of control and really substantial. Exactly. That is exactly my point. That's exactly my point. What is out of control? I didn't use the words. What is substantial problem? What does it mean? Because we have always had incidences of violence in our schools. Zhivargo Sean Laing went to Hawksville High School at the time from 1979 to 1984, the largest school in the Commonwealth of the Bahamas. In the period that I was at Hawksville High School, there was never a police officer on those school grounds, not before nor after many incidences that had taken place. When I say many, I mean, you know, I could count the number of stabbings, fights, and so forth there at the school. So this isn't new. This is back in between 1975 and 1984. I recall in maybe eighth, ninth grade, a young man being stabbed. He didn't die, but he was stabbed on the school grounds, right? So what is substantial? Is it one incident? And what is the nature of the incident? Is it a stabbing? Is it a shooting? Is it a, what is it that makes it out of control, substantial? Two, three, four? The fact that you are asking me, I mean, I ask you, what do you know other than what you read in the newspaper about the incidences in our schools? And as a percentage of our overall population, what do you know to be true about that? I say, how am I measuring it? How am I? You have me mixed up, friend. It's not me measuring it. I didn't put police in schools. This, you have to ask the people who did so. Say, is your measurement quantitative or qualitative? Man, you got all the right questions. You just need to ask them to the right people. I'm the wrong person. I'm asking the question. I ask, when is it the right time to do it? And I ask, what is the evidence? That's what I'm asking. What is the evidence of out of control? And you rightly ask, what is out of control? You are right to ask that question. Ask the policymakers, though. Don't ask me. Says, but one, okay, this is not one, and you can't be listening to this show if you are addressing one. Their laws coincide with their religion. As a, oh, you must see, you are far behind, my friend. Yeah, I don't know. So you've been listening to Mr. Vaughn's show. All right, so we're going to take a break, and then when we come back, we're going to look at some other issues related to police in school. You're listening to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. We'll be back after this break. I'm not afraid
to take a stand. Take a stand. One thing there is no debate about is that BTC has the best rates. Now, the best rates just got better because you pay half the price of the other guy. BTC home internet and mobile services combined. Switching to BTC is a no-brainer because I pay less with BTC and get super fast internet with speeds up to 600 megs. The other guys, their internet only go up to 105 megs.
Get all the internet you want at half the price when you bundle your home internet and mobile. Visit a BTC store to make the switch today. Conditions apply.
If you're looking to diversify your portfolio, chart a course for RF Mutual Funds, where you can get global returns through our suite of internationally invested funds. Get exposure in U.S., Asian, European, and emerging markets without central bank approval. And with financial services leader Morgan Stanley as the advisor of our international funds, you can benefit from RF's global connections. Set sail for international markets today by visiting rfgroup.com. RF, money at work.
We believe in relationship banking. We take pride in getting to know our clients. You have access to knowledgeable, approachable ambassadors and financial coaches so that we can recommend the best product for you. At Fidelity, we care about you. From your financial health to your physical health, we can relate to you because we're just like you. Come and start your relationship banking experience with us today. Visit us online at fidelitygroup.com. Visit any of our branches in Nassau or Grand Bahama, or phone 356-7764 in Nassau, or 352-6676 for Freeport. Fidelity, we're good
for you. I'm not afraid to take a stand.
Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. So glad you could go ahead, caller. We're listening to you. Oh, we dropped the caller. Okay, I'm so sorry. If you want to call back, please feel free to do so. Sorry about that. So we're talking about police in school, right? So if I can, I don't know what the justification is for it, because I am not aware of any data that tells us, other than the incidences that we have had happen of late that have been reported, notwithstanding we have had many a days where we have been having schools and no incidences. So I don't know if we are in a special circumstance or not. We have a caller on the line. Go ahead, caller, we're listening to you.
Good afternoon, Mr. Laing. How are you?
I'm okay, and yourself?
Awesome, awesome. It's a very good question that you're asking today. Mm-hmm. And my response to that question would be, I think police in school is a good preventative measure. Because if you consider, and if they ask for data, if they ask for data on that, if you consider putting a speed cop on a motorcycle on these major intersections, you will find that there will be less people taking chances of running the lights or even, you know, trying to do any form of crime. You know, if you know that there's a roadblock somewhere, you're not going to put a gun in your vehicle and go through a roadblock. So I think it's a good preventative measure that the Minister of Education
But let me ask you a question, because again, you are in an area, you're talking about an area of what you think. And unfortunately, somebody could come right behind you and think something different. So we have to be able to, at least at some point, to arrive at some evidence-based something. So let's take your example. Have traffic violations been going up since 1973 or down?
I would have gone up, and I wouldn't say it's gone down.
My brother, you don't have to think about that. The police publishes crime statistics practically every year. And yeah. I can guarantee you that the traffic violations just in the last 10 years isn't as low as they were, they are now.
But that is simply because, Mr. Laing, we don't have speed cops on the main thoroughfares.
Are you serious? But are you serious? I just saw a speed cop in Grand Bahama booking people just now.
Okay, right. Okay, you're saying.
And they are also in New Providence. There's a whole division of cops and road traffic people. There's a whole division of it.
Let me put it to you like this, Mr. Laing. A lock is not basically to stop a thief. You know, it would slow a thief down, but a lock is basically to keep the honest man honest. Now, whereas you have children who may not be involved in gang relations and other things, if they see a police in school, that police serves as a lock. You know, that keeps you thinking that, you know, if I get involved in this, I'm going to get in problems with that police.
My friend, you have police officers in the Commonwealth of the Bahamas. Do we not have drug trafficking? Do we not have murders? Are we not concerned about murders still?
Well, basically, then what you're saying to me then is our police is worthless, so we might as well fire them all and just.
No, don't put words in my mouth. I'm saying something different to you. You came to me with your thoughts. I challenged your thoughts with a question about evidence. And then you put an example to me. I challenged that with a counter argument. So that it's not a question of my surrendering. I'm saying what we have to do is get beyond our opinion and thinking and see if we can actually find impactful solution. And I'm going to talk to you about some things that some people are doing some places in the world that actually have evidence of effectiveness.
Well, Mr. Laing, I hear you, but as a citizen in the country, I'm going to tell you, when I see a police, you know, I make sure everything is in order with me, all right? A police for me, says to me that there is the law, and if you break that law, he's going to deal with you. So for me, that seeing that police officer keeps me in line as a citizen. So, you know, if you are a citizen that just have no respect for the police, and feel like they could challenge that authority, that's on them. I'm not going to do it.
Yeah, but you're right. But here's what you missed, though. You know the scripture says that laws are not made for the unrighteous. For the righteous, it's made for the unrighteous. Did you ever read that?
Yeah, that is correct.
Okay, so it was never about you, because you were not going. You were telling me that if the police wasn't around, you would have break the law.
But let people take chances. Men police.
No. Forget people. You use yourself as an example.
Well, I'm not going to tell you I've never run a light because I have not seen the police.
Okay,
I
go.
I have my hate and in my emergency runs and stuff. I have took that chance before, but then there were times when I've had emergency when I wanted to run a light. If I see a police officer, I say, brother, you better get your head together.
Yeah, but there have been drug traffickers who were going to carry their drug traffic on a certain route and decided not to because the police was on that route.
Right.
How are you and them different?
So my point then is, Mr. Laing, yes, the police does serve as a deterrent. Okay, so if there is
for the people willing to obey the law, but what about the people unwilling? You believe that a young person in school who is determined to strike out and do it somebody ain't gonna wait till the police gone or ain't gonna wait till the opportune time to do so? That's what criminals do.
Well, Mr. Laing, we need to find them and weed them out because we don't need people like that in this society. We need to weed them out and deal with them.
Why you think God didn't weed Cain out before he killed Abel? Huh? God must have not had enough information, eh?
He surely must not have had
enough power.
No, God didn't do it because he gave man free will.
Okay, there you go. So what's the police supposed to do about a man with free will and school who hiding from him and hiding and gonna bushwhack somebody?
Well, Mr. Laing, the police better figure out how to deal with it. That's all.
I got you, brother.
That's their job. They better figure out how to deal with it.
I got you, buddy. See, take care, man.
Thank you. Yeah, man.
All right. Have a good one. You know, I'm not trying to give him a hard time, but I'm trying to give his thoughts a hard time because this is where we get pressed to find more than what might be regarded as, you know, just impulsive reactions to the things that's happening in our society, right? Because, you know, we want to do what's sensible, not just what feels good. There are lots of things that feel good. There are lots of things that give us cause to pat ourselves on the back and say, yeah, we're doing something. But that's not always, we're not always doing something. All right. So let me field some questions for you as you think about police in school. First of all, right? So I've already asked the first one, what's the evidence that you really need it now? Right? That's the first question. The second one is, like, when you put a police in the school, what's the scope of responsibility you give to the police? See, when you put a police on the street in the Bahamas, you give them a scope of responsibility, right? It's law enforcement, right? Now, they have a way that they are taught to carry out that enforcement, right? And you've seen it on display, good and bad ways, right? And so they have a scope. When you put them in a school with minors, let's remember this now. The schools are territories for minors. They are not adults. They are minors. The vast majority of them are under 15 years old. Under 15 years old, right? So could the commissioner of police or the minister of national security say to me, okay, the police in school have been charged with this responsibility. And I'm going to show you how in many different places in the world, the police are actually given different responsibilities. They're not given the same responsibilities as they are given in the general society. And there are studies that question whether or not they should be given the same responsibilities in the schools as they're given in the general society. Okay, so that's the second question. Now, the other question is, which officers do you put in the schools? Do you put a young officer or an older officer? A more experienced officer or a less experienced officer? Or a combination of? Huh? Do you put undercover officers or do you put covert officers in there? Or do you put a combination of both? Do you put seniors? Or do you put junior officers, or do you put a combination of both? Do you put on duty officers, as is the case in some countries, or you put off-duty officers. What do? And when you put the officers in there, what is the objective? What do you say to them is their objective? Is their objective law enforcement? Or is their objective mentoring and education? Is it surveillance? Is it prevention? And is it, or is it student safety? What is the objective given to the officers? That's important, right? Now, in looking at this issue of police officers in schools, I can tell you, looking at any number of studies that have been done, there were studies done by NAR and in 2011. There were studies done by Horner and Fisher in 2019. There are studies done by Ellen et al. In 1994. There were studies done by Bradford and Yesberg in 2019. And there's a host of studies. One of the things that has come about is this. Very little study has been done on the impact of police in school in terms of effectiveness. Very, very little has been done. Okay, so there's not an abundance of evidence. What the studies do point to is that there certainly is a universal belief amongst stakeholders that putting police in school is helpful. That's certainly what the stakeholders tend to believe, that it's helpful, even though there's not really much evidence to support that it is. What the research also shows, and here's where you got to think about it, friend, is this. Police presence in school has also come with increased arrest and the students put before the justice system for both minor and major incidences. And that those have resulted in many more of those students finding themselves impeded in their life circumstances because of an arrest record and or prosecution, conviction for crimes, even minor crimes. And that those are people who end up, again, in life going through the judicial system. So whereas, you know, somebody may have gotten caught in a fight in school and the principal and those deal with it and reprimand the student and so forth, it's an assault. Maybe, and I know and I know, incidences in which students were found with something like a knife or a weapon, et cetera, a principal knowing the circumstance and the students have a talk and with the parents and all that kind of stuff. The incident gets resolved, nothing goes a bit, then boom, the child moves on, has a great life. Maybe some of them fall away, but has many of them have a good life. And then the police now sees you with a weapon and the police charged with the responsibility that they're charged with, catches you with a weapon, you're hauled before a juvenile panel or wherever else and so forth, arrested for this, and boom, you next thing you know, you're on your way to being one of them hardened, in quote, hardened criminals. So one of the things that is found is that when you put police on the campuses, depending on what you have charged them to do, you end up with more cases of students being arrested and charged with criminal offenses, small and not so small. Laing, go ahead, caller, we're listening to you. Hi, go ahead, caller.
If you'd like to...
Okay. We have some text here, let me get to. This text says, Zhivargo, you... Jeez, listen to me, man. First of all, I can read you all this because I can't believe what this person, this first of all, it says, Zhivargo, you pretty, you don't read my text, you drop my call, but Z lad, you is Pentad leader, so be real. You is Pentad leader. Wow. This text is minors doing grown-up things and committing crimes. Okay, yeah. Things and committing crimes. Okay, yeah. So what are you saying to me? I don't understand that. Says, good afternoon, Mr. Laing. I do not think the problem in our schools is out of hand. Reason being, there are still more good students than bad by a good number. However, I do fear we have some negative or violent incidents that cannot be ignored. I agree with you 100% on that. 100%, my friend. It says, good day, Mrs. Belinda Wilson already answered all of these questions earlier on one show. Really? She did? Okay, well, she didn't answer it on my show. So what do you want me to do? If she wants to call here, I'd be happy to have Belinda anytime. She knows that. And by the way, Brother Kermit, our producer, happy birthday, my friend. Happy, happy birthday. Faithful producer, Kermit. Celebrating with you, but 18 today, bro. Listen, man, have a happy one. Have a blessed one. Have a blessed. Got some more texts here. You're welcome, man. You're welcome, man. You're welcome. Listen, man, let me tell you something. Don't take it for granted, boy. You know, that coming on planet Earth and get that opportunity, producing them kids and living this life and making your contribution, that's a wonderful thing. Wonderful, wonderful thing. It's Texas. Hi, Mr. Laing. There are police all over the city and their presence do not deter crime of any age or gender. So how then can it be shown that a police in the school will help? I now wonder if that's the case. Maybe more fights will be after school. There you go. You know, I've always said that I made a speech in the parliament years and years ago in which I said, we always hear people say that we have to break the back of crime. And I said, that's really actually a thing we say that is not in keeping with the way crime is. Not a vertebrae, which has a back. Crime is an invertebrate. Because what happens is when the police does something, the criminals adjust their behavior to accommodate the new realities of the police. That's the nature of crime. And we've seen that over the course of human history. The police does one thing, the criminals do another thing and adapting to it. And that's what invertebrates do. That's why snakes can worm their way through this, that, and the next thing. And you know what? You're wondering how they got in. Because they're invertebrate. They don't have no back to break. So you ain't gonna break the back of crime. Crime, you can't break the back of crime. You gotta, anyway. This text says, great show as usual. I think judges weigh certain situations out because sending a person to jail will or could ruin someone and someone's entire life. It certainly can be impactful on a person's life, that's for sure. And I think that's what the researchers have been trying to ascertain in some of their research is whether police presence in schools does not create this new phenomena of more arrest and more prosecution of juveniles that create more challenges for them. See, I pray to God that officers will not have to use deadly force to stop a deadly fight in schools. I believe that if officers would have to use deadly force on a student, we won't hear the end of that. It's a good point. So minors doing grown-up things and committing crimes, so send the police in and show them what grown-ups get when they act up. Yeah, you must not have children. It's not up children, because you could say that now. Say anything when you don't have children. And when it ain't your children and it ain't your people affected, you can say anything. Ladies and gentlemen, we're going to take a break for news. You're listening to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. A lot more to discuss when we come back on this crime, this police and school matter. We'll be back after the news. Whatever weather, cold or warm.
D Did you know that you can request and pay for over 35 government services on mygateway.gov.bs? Sign up today and access government services online with efficiency and simplicity. It's a celebration of a year of collective success on our digital transformation journey. My Gateway, making government work for you.
Babe, you mashed the car?
I mashed the car. The lady run into me mashed the car.
I hope she had insurance.
If she had insurance, she hop out, pull out her phone, pull up the Royal Star Assurance app, and bang, she was on a video call with an RSA rep, sending pictures of her damage, my damage, filing a claim on the spot.
For real? Our insurance have that kind of app?
You gotta go to RSA for that.
Download the RSA app today or visit rsabahamas.com to submit your claim online. Live chat available weekdays 9 to 5.
Five-time defending Carifta Swimming Champions Team Bahamas is headed to Barbados April 16th through 20th. Swimming Championships. Show your support for Team Bahamas by placing an ad in the Nassau Guardian Special Carifta Swimming Championship section, which will be published on April 4th. This is your chance to congratulate Team Bahamas, the coaches, or an individual swimmer in their quest for a sixth title. For more information, call your Nassau Guardian account executive now at 302-2300, 302-2300, and get your message in our special Carifta Swimming Championship section. Get ready for the 2022 Carifta Swimming Championships and Team Bahamas going for gold again.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM, Nassau, Bahamas.
I'm not afraid to take a stand, take a stand. Everybody, everybody, come take my hand, come take my hand. We'll walk this road together through the storm, whatever weather, cold or warm. Send holler if you feel like you've been down the same road.
Welcome back. Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to We Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. So glad you could join us here today on Guardian Radio 96.9 FM on this beautiful Wednesday afternoon, where we're talking about putting police in schools. Before you draw a conclusion about what it is that I believe about this situation and what should be done, please, please reserve your conclusion until I'm done. We have a caller on the line. Go ahead, caller. We're listening to you.
Hi, Mr. Laing. How are you?
Hey, I'm doing good. How are you?
Wonderful. I was prompt to call when you said today is Kermit's birthday.
Yes, yes, yes.
Well, today is my birthday as well.
Woo! Well, happy, happy birthday to you,
that's
girl.
That's why I was prompt to call.
I want to wish
Kermit a happy birthday.
You're 19 now?
Okay.
You'll take it, eh? Did we lose her? If you want to call back, I don't know. We must have lost you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to all of you who are celebrating today. So, yeah, don't draw any conclusion. Don't draw any conclusion about what I think here. So let me give you some more information, right, about what I found about the police in schools. So, you know, a study of studies on the effectiveness of police in school that was done. And this study was done by Bradford and Yesberg in 2090. It's an evidence review study. It's an evidence review. What they found was that, again, there's limited information out there to compare situations in which there's police schools with police and schools without police, and what the difference that was made in terms of violence or whatever else on the campuses. So they acknowledge in the review that there's limited information. They also acknowledge that in their review of various countries, that there were differences in the way policing in school, where it was done, has been done. But they do note that the assumption made by the general population is that putting police in schools is positive. So just like many people in the Bahamas believe this to be true, universally across countries, that is what the review showed, that many people believe that that's a positive thing. But here is what has been discovered by Bradford and Yesberg in their 2019 evidence review. What they found was, in the United States of America, the police were put in school, and this is the mandate the police was given, to enforce the laws and for enforcement purposes and surveillance purposes. That's pretty much what they were put in the schools to do. And that secondary was mentoring and education. Okay, so their primary responsibility was enforcement and surveillance, secondarily mentoring and education. In the United Kingdom, on the other hand, what they found was that the police were put in school to prevent crimes and to keep students safe. That was the objective given. Now, the study found that one of the studies done, so remember, this was a review of studies about presence in schools. And one of those studies found that in the United Kingdom, the presence of police in schools resulted in less truancy. Truancy is children missing school. Less victimization, meaning less students being the victims of crime, and better feeling among students of safety. So that's what they found in the United Kingdom. In the United States, however, the study found that no difference existed. There was no such positive developments as they saw in the United Kingdom. Now that's interesting, because you see that the approach in the United Kingdom was regarded as more effective than the approach in the United States. And what was the approach in the United Kingdom? Prevent and keep students safe, not enforce and surveil. The United Kingdom took a different approach to the exercise. Now, another study done in Akron, Ohio found this, that where they used off-duty police officers in what was called a cooperative program, where the police came into the school, these are off-duty police, who came into the school environment, familiarized themselves with students, and were given this responsibility. One, remove non-students from the premise. That's the responsibility. Two, intervene in criminal incidences. Intervene in criminal incidences of violence. And then three, make presentations to the classroom. Those three things. They found that among all the stakeholders where that kind of cooperative program occurred, they all found the program. That's Ellen et al. 1994 study, okay? Peter Price, in 2009, notes this. Says a key component of the, in quote, school to prison pipeline is the constant presence of police in schools. And the question raised in the Price study is, do police officers in school conduct themselves the same way as they would in the general society? And Price makes the argument that they should conduct themselves, meaning that there are rules that govern their behavior, such as you can't approach somebody without reasonable cause. You have to exercise a certain kind of protocol in dealing with the matter, and so forth and so forth. And so the contention is they should do the same thing. But in many instances, the police officers dealing with these minors tend to take on a different posture than they would take on in the general society. What is my take? Do we have a caller on the line? Go ahead, caller, we're listening to you. Hi, go ahead, caller, we're listening to you.
Laing, how are you doing?
Hi, how you doing?
Okay, let me tell you something now. Let me give you the real facts. I was a teacher at the boys' school.
Okay.
Yeah, and I spent 14 and a half years there. And they sent me off to Jamaica to school, sir. But when I come back, they take discipline out of school. So, Zhivargo, when you take discipline out of school, what do you expect?
Can I ask you a question? Did they take discipline out of school?
They didn't want the officer or the teacher to correct the boys when they behave bad.
No, you mean corporal punishment.
There ain't no corporal punishment, man. No, man. Corporal punishment when you authorized by a magistrate or by the superintendent give it 6 or 8 stroke. Corporal punishment is different from a minor correction, you see?
When I was Minister of State in Education, a child was disciplined by a teacher in one of the schools, S.E. McPherson, I think it was, and the child subsequently died, not because of the beating, but the child subsequently died. And they then changed the rule to say that a teacher could not administer, and the words were corporal punishment, sir. I'm sorry.
You're right. Okay. That's what they used, you see?
And then they said that only the principal or someone authorized by the principal, therefore, could do so. So when you say you got
good memory. I remember that. Go ahead.
Okay, so when you say they took discipline out of the school, I'm saying, as far as I am aware, it is still possible in terms of physical punishment to discipline a child, but it has to be administered by the principal or someone authorized. Now,
well, that came down after what? After a couple of years ago, it began almost 20 years ago, you see?
Yeah, but that's what I don't know what the situation is now, but you can discipline a child. It's just a question of what kind of discipline.
We were told. And then the fact, man, I got 8 children, sir. And I don't fool around my children. I tell them the routine. And when I tell you once, I ain't going to talk no more. Talking is cheap. I will correct you, sir, in a good, understanding way.
Well, I'm like you. When I was a younger parent, a younger father, I certainly disciplined my children and I used to use a belt on their butt.
Well, that's a belt or a small tantrum stick. You got a tantrum one
I used to use a belt. I never used to use a stick. I used a belt, right?
Yeah.
As I grew older, I really moved away from that. Now, that didn't mean I despised it, because my wife still, you did it, and I didn't think that she was wrong for doing so. I just knew that it should be done in a certain way if it was going to be done. But I got away from it because I just felt like it wasn't necessary. I used other means. And I don't think that I haven't observed any differences in behavior between the children who got it the most and the children who got it the least.
Yeah, but that is true, because I whip mine good, and when they get extra rude, I put the extra weapon on the bottom, you see? And I tell them that's what he did, and that's what you must do better. What you're doing, you're obscene, cursing the neighbor, you're cursing this. No, sir, I say, I do adults, that kind of thing.
Let me ask you a question. You are at the boys' school.
I've been there 14 and a half years.
Yeah, when you were there, were you able to discipline children like spanking and that kind of stuff?
No, after the new superintendent come there, named Mr. Teacher come there. He say he don't want nobody correct the boys and whatnot. So I asked him.
But when it could be done,
It could be done by the superintendent, the head office.
Okay, but when it was done, do you think it made a difference in those boys' lives? Have you seen?
Yeah, it's different because what I did. Let me tell you. I used to do 3 sports. The officer in charge, in the barbershop, and the sport. I used to challenge them on the field. I get them on the field and wake up. We just do the relay and run. That's why I did that. They might not recognize me, but they should. My name is Eliza Orlando Ferguson. I'm from Auckland, sir.
Well, I appreciate you calling, sir. I really appreciate it. Thank you.
Yeah, Police Force, They need to put undercover police. We used to go there lunchtime and after school out. See, after school out, well, we don't, didn't put the police in there. You see, they just monitor and they conduct because they was getting out of hand, so they had to tighten up.
Okay.
You see my point?
Thank you very much. I appreciate you calling.
Bye-bye.
Thank you, sir. All right. This text says, if these rude children are not learning manners at home, then I feel that the schools are the next best place. So send the police in to assist and enforce the rules of the schools and civil society. These kids can understand. If no intervention early on in life, they will eventually become a menace to society. And who will end up paying for that? The citizens and government. So send the police in now. Okay, you think that's the rationale? I hear you, bro. I hear you. You think that a parent who has responsibility for the child over the course of many hours in a day can't discipline the child and get the child to behave. A teacher, a wonderful human being who is there to give this child education and knowledge for 6-7 hours in the course of a day, they can't do it. So you can send a police officer in there because the police officer, according to you, is trained in how to help you become a mannerly person. You really think in your logical, rational mind that that is true? Seriously? I mean, really? You really believe that? Okay. I hear you. Says, I think the intentions by putting the police is that it will deter crime by minimizing its government's hit. Governments are not that ignorant to think they could entirely stop crime, but they could minimize crime to acceptable levels. Yeah, but here's the thing, though. You say, I think the intentions. Why do you need to think what the intention is? If the government does executes a policy, why can't they just tell you what the aim and objective is? So you don't have to think. Just go read the minister's notes and see if he said to you what the intentions are. This text, we have a call on the line. Go ahead, caller. We're listening to you. Go ahead, caller. We're listening to you. Hello. All right. Not sure what's going on there. We just have to find out from the minister what he says is the objective. And just that's how policy objectives are known. Those who execute the policy give you what the objectives are. I'm reading a story in the Nassau Guardian by Jasper Ward. And the story says, the Davis administration has reintroduced the presence of police officers in government schools. Assistant Commissioner of Police Craig Stubbs said yesterday that 13 police officers have been deployed to 9 schools in New Providence, with another 3 schools under consideration for deployment. The 9 schools are Government High School, Doris Johnson Senior High School, Aaron Bailey Senior High School, C.C. Sweden Senior High School, C.B. Bethel Senior High School, S.C. McPherson Junior High School, T.A. Thompson Junior High School, A.F. Ali Junior High School, and C.H. Reeves Junior High School. End quote. The whole intention is for the officers to be at the school to assist the administration with initiatives that will incur disruption within the schools. Is that right? Within the classes or with students engaging in physical altercation. So what are the intentions? For the officers to assist the administration with initiatives that will, I think, means ensure disruption within the schools, within classes, or with students engaging in physical alteration. So I take that to mean initiatives, meaning you get together with the administration and you and they decide, okay, this is probably the best way for us to avoid this or prevent that. And the next thing, he says, we will aim to identify students who may be involved in gang activities. That's surveillance. When need be, reach out to our supporting departments like the National Crime Prevention Unit to assist students with dealing with conflict resolution and other issues that may cause a student to be disruptive during the time that they are on the school campus. That could be a cooperative program. So that's, again, you don't have to, that's the police saying this, you know, this is not the Minister of National Security. But the police is responsible for executing the policy the minister wants. We have a call on the line. Go ahead, caller, we're listening to you.
Good afternoon, Mr. Laing.
Hi, how you doing?
I'm okay, sir. You know,
you sound low, though. I'm not sure why.
Hello?
Yes, that's better.
Okay, sir. I am not a big proponent of putting police back, you know, these police in school, but you have to be very careful here, because when you criticize or you bring out about objective criticism, sometimes, you know, the politicians have a tendency to catch some type of feeling, you know. But my thing is this. What are the independent schools doing differently from what the public schools are doing? Because they're all here on this 21/7 island, but we don't see any police officers in the private school sector, say.
That is, my friend, you ask a very relevant and pertinent question. But we do have a quick answer to that, you know.
You know, just but my thing is, my thing is this, Mr. Laing. A few days ago, I posted on my Facebook page, I stated that we need to look at placing mobile police stations throughout the inner city. And reintroducing policemen on bicycles and perhaps ATVs. 2 days later, I saw where a mobile police station was placed there in the city. And I came back 2 days later, I stated that we need to have a crime symposium, a conclave, where we invite all of the stakeholders, the police, members of parliament, civil society, NGOs. 2 days later, I heard about a crime conclave. But I wasn't talking about no crime conclave coming out of directly to the Prime Minister's office. Each constituency, but 16, 17 constituencies in New Providence, let's look at New Providence. Each constituency has a maximum of, what, about 5,000 voters? Why can't we have a crime, a conclave in each respective constituency? That's basically what I was talking about, you know? And let's look at what is fueling these anti-social behavior.
Well, let me ask you a question. Let me ask you a question, please.
Yes, sir.
Like, the people who you are going to bring in the conclave live in this society. What will they find out at a conclave they don't know already living in the society where all these children coming from?
Well, basically, we know, but for example, if I live in a particular constituency and I want to participate, I would know, the community knows me. They know whether or not I am a good parent or a bad parent. I myself exercise anti-social behavior. When you do it from a national perspective, you're not really going to get the type of people that you really want. You want people who have been tested and who have been tried. For example, my daughter graduated from university at age 20. As a single father with 2 degrees. And I know exactly what she was doing in school because I took the time out to participate in every PTA meeting. Either I was the president or I was the vice president of the PTA. You see what I'm saying? So when I go to pick up a report card, Mr. Laing, I knew exactly what to expect.
Okay.
But, sir,
what we shouldn't do is we can't have anecdotal evidence that suggests this is how things work. Because let me give you an example. I didn't go to a lot of PTA meetings, that's for sure, especially given the responsibilities I had. I didn't do a lot of it. I am not a single father, but I have 4 children, two boys who've already graduated university and both of whom working in the financial services sector. I have a daughter who's in third year university. None of them have ever been before the courts or in any kind of problems, et cetera, and so forth and so forth. But I can't use that to say I know exactly what to do to keep children from.
Because
I take you back to a time. I take you back to tell me what God did wrong to have Adam kill Eve and to Adam and Eve disobey him.
Listen to me, Mr. Laing. Right now in Halifax, in Halifax. You Google it. They haven't had any murders for the year. When you have the system, this is how it works. When you have the system who celebrate that we do under triple digits in murder, when the world standard, this is not my statistics, this is the UN standard, 5 murders per 100,000. So we have 400,000 persons. So in our worst case, we're supposed to be doing, what, 20? And we have politicians celebrating when we do under triple digits? Come on, man. We have to put people in there who understand, who did the research, who understand exactly where we should be.
What do you mean we have to put people in there? If you won't go in there, you got to go get elected?
I'm talking about committees. I'm talking about youth advisory boards. I'm talking about these are the type of people. But it seems as if that in order to be a part of something, you got to be a reverend. You got to be a so-called doctor. I don't know, but these are the type of people that they use. And, I mean, look, gang, we have been hearing about gang from the 1980s. This is now 2022. So what are you saying? We have a 40-year problem. You think those persons who started out in gangs are still there? In the 80s?
Get you to do anything. Hello?
Yes, hello. I could hear you, but I could barely hear you.
Yeah, what I was saying was, it's not just a question of don't put the right people, because you call upon the people you know.
You don't have to call a person who you know. You said you need all persons on board. You need everybody on deck, right? I heard about the conclave on Sunday. I don't know about no conclave. So those people were handpicked. If you want all hands on deck, then let's say you're going to put all hands on deck. But you can't just be handpicking certain people and expect to get... I mean, these are people who have always been involved in these things, and we are still here. I mean, this is hard, sir. We already did 34 murders for the year.
I'm asking you a question. Have you written a letter to the Prime Minister or the Minister of National Security?
I haven't written... Over the years, I've done so. Over the years, for the past 19 years, I've been doing. I've led a charge in this country and gotten the Child Protection Act passed in Parliament. And there are flaws in that particular bill, that act now, that my findings, I've made recommendations since 2007, 2008, 2009, but I can't even get a seat in the Child Protection Council for 19 years. But the U.S. Embassy recognized my work, and in 2006, they recognized me for human rights.
Listen, yes. I don't want to have a discussion so much about you, right?
No, because it ain't about me. Hold on.
Let me give you an example of something. You told me there hasn't been a homicide in Halifax this year. All right? I'm reading a story, March 28, 2022. A talented young basketball player are describing the victim of a homicide in Halifax Saturday morning.
Okay.
And you know why I took a particular interest in it? Uh-huh. Because my son is in Halifax. He works there.
Okay, you said one on Saturday.
I'm just saying this is the story. Because here you have an example you're using, but they have had a murder there.
Okay, fine. They had one after you said Saturday, perhaps, but I didn't know. My point is, they have over 11 million people.
No question, we in the Bahamas got much more nonsense carrying on in this country than many places, many times our size should have more. There's and there is no question that there are countries who do a much better job.
So what are we going to do?
Well, that's what we have to decide. But I know what we can't do is, if we keep doing this opinionating, if we keep doing this, shooting from the hips kind of thing, we're not going to be effective. So maybe we should find out what those people are doing.
Exactly my point. But then when you have a poorly socialized individual, Mr. Lang, when you have a poorly socialized, uneducated individual, and you give them a gun, that gun now becomes the equalizer. That's power. That's authority. You, you think they're going to relinquish
that? But who's giving them the gun, though? But who's giving them the gun?
Mr. Laing, I can't tell you for sure who is giving them the gun, but I'll say this: we don't manufacture guns in the Bahamas.
No, but that's not, man. Listen, man, that's not an argument. That's not. We don't manufacture cars here, but we have cars.
Well,
how's that an argument?
Mr. Laing, the problem we are having is we need to remove our egos and allow the system to work. Use the best of the best that you have. Use persons. You don't have to be involved in no gangs.
But who are those, man? See, you sound sensible. I know you seem authentically interested in addressing this. You are very sensible in the things you're saying. But there's a little gap I'm trying to fill with you that I can't fill, man, because I can't understand it. I mean, I don't understand what is it that you exactly want the government to do?
I want the government, for example, when you go in that newborn section, Mr. Laing, you don't see you see innocent babies. So
No. You see, now you're philosophizing. I'm asking you, what do you want the government to do?
You have to look at parenting.
You want the government to look at parenting?
We have to look at the way we parent.
Okay.
And we have to hold parents accountable. If my underage child decide to go afoul of the law and create problems with your child, Mr. Laing, my parental involvement should come into question.
Okay, so let me ask you a question. Do they do that in Halifax?
I can't tell you whether
they do not. They do not.
They have good.
They
have
do not.
Very good.
They don't. They do not. A juvenile in before the court will not have the parent come before the court to answer to that child's crime.
But I'll tell you what they do. I'll tell you what they do.
Mm-hmm.
This is what they do. Right now, for example, if there is a problem with parenting,
mm-hmm.
they have subcommittees. They have committees who would analyze, who would vet the case. As long as there was no criminal actions taken out, they would decide whether or not it's court worthy and try to resolve it before it getting to court. If I have a matter and I go to court, I take it to court. It takes months before I get a chance to get a hearing.
Mm.
That child protection council could be an extension of our court system. We have a lot of lay magistrates. We have a lot of retired magistrates.
Mm-hmm.
We need to address these matters quickly. They don't also put persons, serious murderers on bail.
I want to invite you to do something for me. I want to invite you to do something to me because we could.
Yes, sir.
We can. What they should do. We can do that. But I am at the Government and Public Policy Institute. And the letters that you have sent over the years, if you still can locate them, I'd love to get copies of them so that we can look at them. And I'd be happy at the Government and Public Policy Institute to send them forward to and follow up on them where we send them to the appropriate government ministers and agencies. If you're prepared to do that, I'd be happy to get them.
I'll say this. When you take, for example, when you take a person who is accused or who has been charged for murder and you place them on bail, we see what has been happening over the years, right? But if you set the bail at $1 million, if you set the bail at $1 million and you free up the court system where they can get a speedy trial, we'll have less persons getting killed or that are on bail. Bails are really designed, those ankle braces are really designed for persons who spray graffiti on walls,
Yeah, but I hear you, sir. But I mean, again, that's an opinion you have. Okay, thank
check
you. Thank
developed
you.
Countries to see if they have condemned murderers.
I must check out developed countries and to see if they have what?
That's a fact. They don't have persons charged serious crimes walking around with on ankle bracelets.
They have them out on bail, though?
I don't hear what you say, sir.
Do they have them out on bail?
If they meet the $1 million,
are there murder victims in the United States? Are there murder?
They put them under house arrest. They don't have them. If they put them on bail, they set serious conditions.
I'm sorry. I have to go. I have to go. I really have to go. Thank you. I appreciate it. I tried to be very patient and entertain a lot of your thoughts, but I have to go. Thank you very much. We have another call on the line. Go ahead, caller. We're listening to you. See? I'm sorry. Boy. Anyway, ladies and gentlemen, we're going to take a break for news. And when we come back, we will continue our discussions. You're listening to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. We'll be back after this.
I'm not afraid to take a stand.
How important collecting your money can be to the success of your business. Start your relationship with Fidelity today so that we can show you the many options available to you with our merchant services. From click and pay options online to merchant terminals and e-commerce options, we're here to help your business succeed. For more details, speak to one of our business development officers at 356-7764 in Nassau or 352-6676 in Freeport. Visit our website at fidelitygroup.com or visit any of our branches.
Fidelity, we're good for you.
One thing there is no debate about is that BTC has the best rates. Now, the best rates just got better because you pay half the price of the other guys with your BTC home internet and mobile services combined. Switching to I pay less with BTC and get super fast internet with speeds up to 600 megs. The other guys, their internet only go up to 105 megs.
Get all the internet you want at half the price when you bundle your home internet and mobile. Visit a BTC store to make the switch today. Conditions apply.
If you're looking to diversify your portfolio, chart a course for RF Mutual Funds, where you can get global returns through our suite of internationally invested funds. Get exposure in U.S., Asian, European, and emerging markets without central bank approval. And with financial services leader Morgan Stanley as the advisor of our international funds, you can benefit from RF's global connections. Set sail for international markets today by visiting rfgroup.com. RF, money at work.
Around the world, Cleveland Clinic is recognized as a leader in healthcare. Our team of experts relentlessly pursues the best for our patients. From groundbreaking cancer research to state-of-the-art heart surgery, life-saving innovations happen here every day. When it's time to travel for your health, it's time to travel to Cleveland Clinic. Your destination for care, for every care in the world. To learn more, visit clevelandclinic.org/Caribbean.
Sheila, you okay? I see smoke coming from your window.
Chad, Johnny Mo's burning down the house frying chicken.
Your kitchen is a mess. You have insurance?
If I have insurance, I pulled my phone out, pulled up the Royal Star Assurance app, and in no time, I was on live chat with RSA rep, sent pics of the damage, filed my claim on the spot.
Wow, I don't think my insurance got that kind of app.
You got to go to RSA for that.
Download the RSA app today. Live chat available weekdays 9 to 5.
I'm not afraid to take a stand.
Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. So glad you could join us here today on Guardian Radio 96.9 FM on this beautiful Wednesday afternoon. If you want to give us a call, Or 325-4316 or 325 4259, or you can text me on 4224796 or WhatsApp me on 4393043. See, I listened to that gentleman who called, and he had some sensible things to say for sure. I can tell he's passionate about what he's talking about and really wants to see make a difference. And maybe he's someone who the folks should call upon. And then hopefully if he sends me the information, he might be someone I can tell them. Listen, man, I'll give you an example. He said, you know, in developed countries, you don't see big time serious criminals out on bail. Well, I'm reading from the U.S. Department of Justice's report, and they say like a sixth of the defendants detained until case disposition were held without bail, a sixth. That means the majority of the people were actually granted bail. And murder, in the case of murder, 40%, this was the most likely to be the detained, denied bail. But that means that 60% who were charged with murder were actually granted bail. All right. So, you know, it becomes a kind of, you know, we like to do this. We like to say and suggest that this is happening in these countries, and I'm saying we can't be doing that. What we should do is let's look at the evidence, right? And try and be informed about what is actually happening. So, because that's the only way of conclusion. Somebody says to me, I've been an educator for over 18 years. I can tell you for sure the psychological presence of police officers on campus make a whole lot of difference. It takes too long to phone police for them to arrive at campuses. At times, police presence saved lives and prevented stabbings between students. Security officers on campus has only been given limited power. I don't deny what you're saying at all. I imagine if I had police guards outside my house too, I'd psychologically feel better when I go to sleep at nights as well. Of course I would. So police in the schools, of course you would feel psychologically better. We know the research says that. Most people believe it's a good thing to do. So there's no question about that. Does it make an actual difference to crime incidences? Well, we could look at the numbers and see, right? We could look at the numbers and see whether or not it has made that difference. And that's what we're talking about here. I don't deny that police presence would make somebody feel better. Why wouldn't it? You see police in your own community, you think you feel better because you think, okay, you know, there's less likely somebody is, you think somebody's less likely. Is that true? I've seen police officers right down the corner, and I've seen dudes doing things and the police just don't know. So, you know, feeling better about something and doing better is not the same thing. Okay, and so I'm not going to deny your experience as an educator. We put police in the schools. So here's my take. on the police in school. Here's my take. Should the police never be called to have a presence in the school? My answer, absolutely not. You should never say we should never put police officers in school. That's nonsense. I do not believe that. So are there times when the police officers should be placed in schools? Yes. Yes. There are times when that should happen. When should police officers have a presence in schools? Whenever the community, the education community in a school or a community is unable to maintain order in that environment, meaning unable to keep the vast majority of students safe, to keep them able to function as they ought in school to learn. Whenever the teachers are unable to safely carry out their responsibilities in the main, You need law and order to set in. Why? Because you have no law and order. So the police is there to establish order. If you have order, you don't need the police. If you have disorder, you need the police. How I think is one thing, but do you have this order? If you are in your home, you and your husband, your wife, your children and them could be rowing and carrying on and so forth and so forth. Do you call the police and say, come, you need to be here all the time because we need to know. When does the police come to your home? When it gets to a point where people's lives are at risk, people's health are at risk, when people are fearful for their safety and so forth, when there is no order that you can maintain in that home, you send the police in. When you have a community that's out of order, they're rioting, you can't check, you can't keep your property safe, you can't keep your family safe, etc. What do? You're calling the police. That's when you call in the police, when the established institutions and norms and personnel cannot maintain order in a workplace, in a school, in a church, in a community, in a nation, you get the police to descend on that place to establish law and order. And once law and order is established, carry your backside out of it, because we don't have a police state in this country. Because the best way to run a country is by the voluntary acceptance of the citizenry to comply with the laws. Because if many more of us decide not to obey the law, I can guarantee there ain't nothing the police can do, because there's more of us than the police. That's when you send the police in. When you can't maintain law and order in your institution, external forces with the ability to do it, that's when you send the police in. So if we have a scenario in which we cannot maintain law and order in the schools, the police should be there. We have a call on the line. Go ahead, caller. Hi, caller. Go ahead. Hello? All right. Not sure what's going on. So that's my take. And there is another circumstance in which you can put police in the schools. Based on the evidence that I have seen, if you want the police to go in there as an off-duty regiment of influencers who can, in cooperation, because that's another thing, the study shows, teachers and the police cooperated to produce education programs, that those programs were more effective in helping students to avoid criminal activity. The studies suggest when the police alone did it, it wasn't as effective as when the police, in collaboration with the teachers, did the educational program. So there is another circumstance under which we can send police officers, send off-duty, seasoned, mature, capable police officers in there to become a part of the community by familiarizing themselves with students and understanding what is happening in the dynamics of that school, and being a part of getting rid of people who shouldn't be on that premise, and being a part of intervening where there's criminal activity taking place, and then being a part of a cooperative education program with the teachers in the school, then you can have school, you could have police on the schools in those circumstances. We often think it's an all or nothing scenario. So some people go there and say, oh, we should never have police in the school. I don't believe that is true. Oh, we should always have police in the school. I don't believe that's true either. I believe that the circumstances matter, not only to whether you put police in the school and what you discharge the police to do in the schools. Because every situation is not the same, right? Do we have police in schools in our family islands? Do we have violence in schools in our family islands, as one texter asked? Do we have police in schools in our families? Do we have police in the private schools, as another caller asked? Do we have violence in every public high, senior and junior high school on New Providence? Do we have it in Grand Bahama? Because all of these circumstances are calling out for a studied situation so that we understand the dynamics. Listen, folks, we can learn. We can learn. Every situation is teaching us something. When that child stabbed another child, it was an invitation to learn something. Not merely to react, but to learn what's going on. We swoop in with the police. Did you swoop in with the psychologist? Did you swoop in with the criminologist? Did you swoop in? Because it's an opportunity to learn. Might get it, you know, so we know from what has been done elsewhere that there, like whether it works here, and we don't know, but we just know that there is some evidential information to support that a cooperative police program in the schools could be useful, at least. Can it be so here? We can learn. So someone is sending me a video of two young ladies fighting. Said, what if parents of children under 16 are charged? Who commit the crime? Yeah, I mean, I don't, you know, when you say a parent should be charged for a deed done by a child, you are walking on a very slippery slope. I sit inside my own home. I have four children. So for more than 28, 25, 26 years, I've been a parent. And I have been guiding and directing my children all the while. In my own home, I'm saying to my child, don't do that. And when I turn my back, boom, do it. Am I a bad parent? My child has a will, a free will. And if that child in a moment of opportunity defies my instruction, you now won't blame me? You know what you're teaching the child? What you're teaching when you say that is, you don't have responsibility for nothing you do, because everything you do, somebody else caused you to do. You just created a monster, folk. Anytime you deprive somebody of the burden of the consequences of the choices that they have made, you just created a monster, because a victim is somebody who has no responsibility for doing anything. None whatsoever. Yeah, I jerked him, but my mommy was a bad mommy. My daddy was a bad mommy. Yeah, I shoot him, but the community I was raised in was an awful community. Yeah, I raped her, but the school I went to, they didn't like me. They didn't try to help me. You just created a monster by that kind of thinking. No, man. Things can influence our behavior. Absolutely. No question about it. Bad parenting, bad communities, bad teaching and education, all of those can influence us. But at the end of the day, you making the choice. You making the choice. And you know the choice you're making is wrong. Why? Because you do it in the dark. You do it in secret. You do it and then run away. You did it. You're doing your hardest pounding because you know you're doing it. While you're holding the knife, getting ready to juke, you know you're going to do something bad. That's why you when you do it, you break off running. You don't stay there and say, well, you know, I did a great thing. So therefore, I expect when they come here, they're going to give me an award. You know that's not true. Should there be police in schools? If the circumstances dictate. Do we have such circumstances? I don't know. Not enough information. So we trust the judgment of our leadership, and we'll see the consequences and the results that flow. Anyway, ladies and gentlemen, so glad you could join us here today. God bless you. Have a great, great, great evening. And Naughty is coming up next with the Talking Heads. God bless you all and have a great evening.
Not afraid to take a stand, take a stand. Everybody.